son's views in no way reflect those of the rest of the family. It's a powerful letter. Here's a portion of it that I'll read to you. You can see the whole thing online. On Friday night, my son, Peter Teff, traveled to Charlottesville, Virginia, was interviewed by a national news outlet while marching with reported white nationalists who allegedly went on to kill a person. I, along with all of his siblings and his entire family, wish to loudly repudiate my son's vile, hateful, and racist rhetoric and actions. We do not know specifically where he learned these beliefs. He did not learn them at home. I've taught all my children that all men and women are created equal, that we must love each other all the same. Evidently, Peter has chosen to unlearn these lessons, much to my and his family's heartbreak and distress. Peter Teff, my son, is not welcome at our family gatherings any longer. I pray my prodigal son will renounce his hateful beliefs and return home. Then, and only then, will I lay out the feast. Joining us now is Peter Teff's nephew, Jacob Scott. Jacob, thank you for joining us. I know this is not a comfortable situation for you or the family. I want to play for you some of what your uncle had to say about the reaction to his involvement.
Fascism is just loving your family and doing what's best for your nation. I don't hold anything against them for what they had to say about me because it's the safest thing to do in this political climate. Nazi is a racial slur towards white people. I would say there's no objective way to measure any race above any other race or any person above any other person.
Jacob, how are we to understand what your uncle is talking about and what he's about as a person?
Well, you know, he says that he doesn't believe that there's any objective way to measure one race against another, but what he told me in private was that he believes that black people have inherently lower IQ than white people, that IQ is genetic, and that white people simply have higher IQ, and that makes them better. So if he says that he doesn't believe that white people are superior, he's just lying.
So where do you think this came from in him? I mean, we all read the letter from his father saying he didn't learn this in our house. What's your experience?
Well, you know, I wanted to talk about that. I wanted to talk about how we think that he was radicalized online. You know, back in 2008, 2009, he was like pretty much anybody else in the family. He was a feminist. He was a progressive. He was a vegetarian. But around the time of Ron Paul's presidential campaign back in 2012, he started spending a lot of time on these sort of fringe internet spaces like 4chan and getting all his news from like InfoWars and other places like that. And over time, he just started to move further and further right. And this happened completely behind our backs. The first we had any indication of this was maybe 2 years ago. I mean, we knew he was like a men's rights activist, but around 2 years ago, he showed up to a family gathering and he started ranting about Jews. And I went aside with him and I said, do you identify as a white nationalist? And he's like, yeah, I'm a fascist. And before I could say anything else, he goes, the good kind of fascist, though, by which I mean an efficient one. And, you know, I feel that as a society, we need to be talking about this phenomenon of, like, young white asocial men who are going into these internet spaces and they're becoming radicalized, often without their family's knowledge, and it's becoming a real problem in our society. We see the explosion in popularity of these neo-fascist groups among these young white men, and it's tearing families apart. It's torn my family apart, and it bears, frankly, a scary resemblance to the recruiting tactics of terrorist groups like ISIL.
Mm. You know, a lot of experts see similarities that you take people who are outcasts, who are downtrodden, who are disaffected, and they're looking for a rationale for their own lives, and hate very often can take root there. When the family realized that he was going this way, were there any attempts to try to talk some sense to him?
Yeah, you know, I have had a few conversations with him since this kind of arose as an issue. I had a conversation with him just recently where he was talking about the supposed inherent IQ of the races. You know, people say online, you know, you can't reason with Nazis. And I went into my discussion with Peter, my most recent discussion a few months back, you know, thinking, you know, maybe I can at least get him to question his own beliefs. Maybe I can get him to consider the idea that he might be wrong about some of these things. And I really tried to pose these sort of alternative explanations for all of the social ills that he observes in the world. And ultimately, at the end of it, you know, it just seemed like we were going in circles a lot. You know, he's got like a million reasons for believing everything he believes. And he gets it all from all these different sources. As the guy in the video said, it's like a rabbit hole that they go down, and it just poisons their mind, and you can't get them back from it.
What do you make of what happened with the president yesterday and him saying, you know, there's problems on both sides of what he saw happening in Charlottesville?
You know, I think it's disingenuous. I think it's frankly very upsetting because, you know, only one side is advocating for racial separation and racial supremacy. You know, I consider myself pretty far left. I consider myself a democratic socialist. And Peter has talked to me on a few occasions about how, oh, you guys and us, we should team up. You know, we have the same goals. You know, we're both fighting against the establishment. We're both fighting against the globalists. And, you know, I say to him, you know, Peter, you advocate for racial separation. I advocate for racial reparation. I believe in social justice and equality. There is no similarity between us. You can't compare the Nazis and the people who fight against the Nazis and say that there's some kind of moral equivalency there.
What do you think the president is doing with his statements? What do you think his motivation is?
I think his motivation is, frankly, to try not to drive off the people who have given him their most ardent and loyal support over the years, which are the white nationalists. I mean, when my Uncle Peter, when he showed up to that family gathering and when he was ranting about the Jews, he showed up wearing a Make America Great Again hat. He had two of them. So there's definitely a connection there.
Did he support Trump, or do you think he just saw this president as an opportunity to kind of advance his own agenda?
I think he initially definitely supported Trump. More recently, he's fallen back on sort of this idea that Trump was compromised by the deep state and no longer works for them. But he still regards Trump as this lesson that nationalism can. And he changed the conversation, and you know, things of that nature. But he's always since the start of Trump's campaign, he's definitely been an admirer of Trump, I would say.
Do you know if your uncle has any regrets about how Heather Heyer was killed and all the violence that took place down there?
No, from what he said, it sounds like he blames the Charlottesville police. I'm not sure what his rationale is for that, but, you know, he's said that he's planning some kind of event here in Fargo in October, where he's going to get a bunch of his Nazi friends together. And considering the national profile that he's accrued over the last few days, he very well could end up summoning quite a few Nazis to Fargo. And, you know, we have kind of a sizable progressive anti-fascist movement here in Fargo. And you know, we're going to go out and we're going to counter-protest him for sure. But, you know, who knows how many people he's going to bring. So if there are any people out there who are like, you know, DSA, Black Lives Matter, Women's March kind of people who want to come down and stand by us and march with us, we'd be, you know, more than grateful. We'd absolutely welcome that.
Well, just remember, everybody has a right to speak. You got a right to be there. And the point is to keep it nonviolent and to try to move this country
forward.
That's what everybody should try to be doing, to stand firm for what matters. Jacob, thank you very much for being with us. I'm sorry your family's going through this.